Good evening. So I'm just telling stories, God's favor. He's so good to me. Just telling Sally and Tammy, I got my job, you know, thought it'd be something cool to do, and they said they needed someone in a position that was above mine. I said, well, I'd be interested, and they said, okay, when do you want to go to training? They didn't interview me, they just promoted me. I said, well, what are my options? And then 3 years into that job, they fire someone above me. And my boss, we're going to a baseball game and for a company team building outing, and he's like, so I'm gonna promote you. I need someone, and you're my guy. I said, okay, I'm thinking a couple years down the road, right? Because it's normally 5 years before you get the next promotion. 3 years into it, he says, no, this summer. Next month, I'm submitting you for promotion. And so now I'm a project manager, and I do numbers, and I'm not, I mean, God has favored me and put me in this job. And I was telling these guys, I went to a 10-week training course, my first promotion. They sent me to a 10-week training course. I'm with kids right out of college. They're from Harvard, they're from Yale. They're these brilliant young minds. I'm failing story problems because I haven't taken an algebra class in 15 years. And I'm in my review, and you have to do a self-evaluation, and they do like a midterm training review. And so I'm like failing myself because I got an F in a test, which, you know, I'm an overachiever, so that was pretty hard for me. And what have you know, my GPA in college was a 3.97, so I am intelligent. But so I'm in training, and I'm like, well, you know, these story problems, I mean, I took home extra problems to practice, and they're like, Suzanne, you are the hardest working person in this training class. And we notice that everybody comes to you when they have a question because I have all this other experience. So I might not be able to do a story problem all the way to the end. But they gave me a really good grade because I was a hardworking person, and when we got to certain parts of the class where it was more related to what we do, and I could ace those. I was the only one that got those right. And, you know, and I think back to training, and they give you a prospect, right, someone that we want to work with to analyze as your final project in training. And so people get, like, you know, like the city of Muscatine or the city of Clinton or maybe the Chicago Transit that'll have like, you know, five deals outstanding. You have to analyze for refunding. You have to analyze and do a presentation. I got the state of Illinois. I had to analyze $5 billion in debt. And I like looked at him, I'm like, is this a joke? Like, she's got five deals and my refunding alone is like $800 million. I'm like, is this a joke? They're like, well, we know you can do it. I'm like, we still haven't got hired by the state of Illinois, and it's all these years ago. And then, so I just had an interview last week to get hired by the city of Centerville. And it's a long story, but my boss had just told me that he thought I should fire one of my little tiny clients that was kind of not bringing in a lot of revenue, and, you know, it didn't really do much for him, and do we really need to be spending our time with these little clients? We need to make more revenue, make more revenue, make more revenue. I'm like, John, they've been a good client. They need our help. I feel like I really am making a difference in this city. I want to continue to work with them. Okay, kind of begrudgingly. Fine, if you want to spend your time, be here till 8 o'clock at night and spend your weekends working for this little city. And I'm like, I do. He's okay. So we go to this conference, and I have stalked this person that put out this proposal that wants a new financial advisor. And I have Googled him and stalked him, and I have his picture in my hand. And so I'm at this conference, I'm driving all the way to Iowa City at 5 o'clock for a 2 hour like session before dinner, just so I can meet this one guy. And so I'm with a group and I'm like, okay, I don't wanna be rude, but if I see this guy, I'm leaving, I'm gonna go talk to him. That's the only reason I even came and spent 4 hours for this, you know, little window of time. And I see him and he's talking to the client John told me to fire. He's standing right next to him and they're chatting it up. They went through their training together, they're BFFs. I walk up to him like, I have an introduction. And so I go over and my client is like, oh, I was just telling him, he needs a financial advisor. Soon. I was just telling him how we use you and you are so helpful and you give such good service. And I had a question and you gave me an answer. It was just something I'd worked on just the week before. He got me an answer, you know, and gave me another option that I didn't even think of. I was just telling him how great you are. Yeah. Favor, you guys, like favor. And so I get the interview, I go down to Central, I talk to the guy on the phone, and he's like, well, and so I was asking some questions, well, you're going last. Okay, hopefully I can share something that nobody's talked about. Well, that's the spot I'd want, so I gave you that last spot. Okay, well, that's favor, so I'm thinking, I'm feeling good, and I'm sitting in my car waiting, to go in, and I see a pair come out. It's a father and daughter team that's a competitor of ours, and they're very dynamic and they're very experienced. I'm like, I gotta follow these guys. I'm like, no, I favor. He wanted to talk to me. I spent 35 minutes. He had more questions. He kept coming back. He gave me the spot. I am favored. And I walk in there, and it was wonderful chemistry. They had wonderful questions. The beeper went off. Everybody gets 30 minutes. And they're like, I have more questions. And the administrator was like, well, it's not really fair. We don't want to give her more time than everybody else. I'm like, well, but we have to ask this last question. I didn't leave till like 50 minutes later. And so it's just favor. It is favor. And I'm expecting an offer from them to come be their financial advisor. I mean, whether I win or lose, I mean, God's favor is, he's so good to us. Amen. And I don't expect it. I just know.
Yes.
I don't even like think about it. I just know that I'm favored. I'm blessed. I'm his daughter. Amen. You know, and it always works out. It's those little things that my boss, we get in the car after that conference, he's like, all right, I'm going to crow on this one, Suzanne. You called it. He's like, you never. I said, John, you just never know. You just never know. And I said, praise the Lord. And he's like, yeah, you need to praise the Lord. So, you know, and it's just, it's amazing. Because I think that at the beginning of the year, we had a big hole in our business plan. And one of the other project managers was kind of whining about it a little bit. And my boss sent an email to the two of us that said, well, we just need some hard work and some faith. And I believe that we can do it. And I thought, is this my boss? And I wrote back, amen. I mean, we just don't know. We just don't know. I mean, it's been a long journey working with people together. But everybody knows that it always works out and that we are favored and that we can praise the Lord. That's amazing.
Yes,
so
amen.
Just encourage you to just know you're favored. No, just walk in it. Like, I expect when I need something, it's on sale and it's the last one. I mean, little things, right? When I have a need, it's right there. It's waiting. When I need to talk to someone, they're already giving me a reference before I could get there. I couldn't have paid for that kind of credibility.
Right.
I couldn't have told him anything that was more important than what my client had already just told him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just, it's like that in all things. I mean, I took that job to write official statements, not to be a project manager working on $70 million deals. I mean, God is good.
Yes.
And there are days when I think, what am I doing? This is really hard. But God put me there. He's going to keep me there.
Amen.
It always works out. It always comes together. And there's always a way. There's
Amen.
Always a way. So just trust that he is faithful and that you are favored and good things happen.
Amen. That's it.
Good things happen.
Amen.
So anyway, praise the Lord. So anyway, anybody have any prayer requests? Yeah, Roberto. Have any prayer requests or any testimonies tonight?
looked up my co-worker Tony. They're showing some progress from that incident up in Ankeny. He's responding, starting to get some motion and stuff. And I'm just praying for God to speak to him in dreams and visions where he's at right now. Because I know he doesn't know the Lord, but I keep getting nudged by the Holy Spirit. This is exactly the situation my son was in when the Lord visited him and transformed his life. And I'm praying for transformation in his life too. So,
amen.
And his healing naturally.
Amen. Yes, amen. Anyone else? All right. Sheila?
Diana Tarkin called me yesterday, and she went to see Joey and up at the hospital. She still is in the hospital. I guess her toe was completely black, and they're talking about amputation of part of her foot at this point. So I'm just going to keep lifting her up in prayer for healing, and the Lord's will to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I thought maybe John would share it. Shared on Facebook, but you know, the Lord just continues to bless. I always debate when Tom comes, it's like I give, and then it's like, man, I gotta turn around and give tithes, and I don't know. You're just trying to make sure you're gonna have ends meet, you know. And I knew that this was my week that was not super busy, but the Lord just is always faithful. I got a call today, you know, I was kind of looking at my account and just kind of not balancing here, and I got a move out clean tomorrow, so I thank the Lord that He continues to provide for us,
yeah,
continues to give us favor. And then I had written, we'd really wanted a freezer, and a friend of mine had said, Sheila, if we find a freezer, will you go half and half with me on it? And can we store it at your house? And I'm like, sure, you know, I'll just have to see, because I'm going out to Boston, and I got my daughter coming home, so my finances are really tight right now. But anyway, we had given our neighbor $25 like two times he borrowed from us. And he's moving, and he asked John, instead of paying, if he could just give us a freezer and a two-wheel dolly. We got the better deal. And this thing's huge. I thought it was just a little freezer. It's a freezer. It's like, yes.
Praise the Lord.
You know, so I thank the Lord for his favor. I didn't only just get, you know, the freezer that I can fill up with my vegetables. I got a dolly on top of it, which we've always wanted to have. We just, they disappear from our garage somehow every time we get one. So
that means John doesn't have to borrow mine anymore.
Yeah, right. We have to borrow from everybody we borrow from. Our daughter's moving tomorrow, so we was looking at one the other day. Well, I guess we're just going to have to rent one from, you know, the Rent-A-Center or whatever here. So now we don't.
Praise the Lord.
God's good.
Amen.
Yes, He is.
Amen.
Amen. All right, anybody else? All right, well, let's stand if no one else has anything to share. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we walk in favor, Lord, that we are your children, Lord, and that we can expect the good gifts, Lord, that we just walk in it, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you know our needs before we even ask, Lord, that you have laid those riches in our paths, Lord, that we just simply walk in it, and we thank you and we praise you, Lord. That it is you, Lord. You are the author of every blessing, Lord. That you are the source of every blessing, Lord. We thank you for the healings, Lord, the need to come, Lord. We thank you for the manifestation, Lord, of those. We thank you, Lord, that you alone will receive the glory in every situation, Lord. For Joni, Lord, we lift up that body, Lord, that you have your way, Lord, in that body, Lord.
Thank you,
for Roberto's family, for Ariadna's family, Lord, for her father, Lord, that you can cast out every unclean spirit, Lord, every disease, Lord, every malfunction in this body, Lord, you can cast them out, Lord, with one word, Lord. Jesus, that you are our example, Lord, and you just said, go, come out and be gone in Jesus' name. Given us the authority, Lord, that we are your bridegroom, Lord, that we are betrothed, Lord, that we walk and have our being in you, Lord, that we have the authority of your name, Lord, sealed for your good work, Lord, in this world, Lord. Jesus, Jesus, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. We don't have to beg. just simply believe. We just believe and we trust in you, Lord. This Friday, Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Focusing on memorials. Memorials of those serving. Memorials of those who have served. Stood up for freedom. For righteousness. And godliness. Also the memorials of the Lord. The things that he has promised us. The benefits. The blessings that he has poured out on us. To remember those things. And to remember if we are lacking in any of those things. To remember he has promised these things.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Jesus. John, you want to come take the offering tonight? Thank you. Ask the blessing, please. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Jeez.
I just saw Joshua and those crossing the Jordan to go into the promised land, and it looks like there's that same amount of people here tonight. It's time for us to go into the promised land, only it won't be Joshua and Caleb, the only ones going victorious. We're all going to go through, and we're going to check out the promised land and prepare the land for the rest of those who may not be here tonight and those who haven't been here yet that are coming.
Amen.
We're going to claim it for the Lord in the name of Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Thanks. Blood of the Lamb, the word of the day. Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You are worthy, 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 worthy. Hallelujah, Lord. You are worthy, 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 worthy. Worthy, worthy, are you, Lord. You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and nevermore will reign. At the end of the age when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. A shield in our hands and a sword in our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. And the Father has told you for these who have died, for the nations that gather before you. Shout!
Your blood is so strong, Lord. Your blood is so strong, Lord. It's alive. It still sets people free, Lord. Your kingdom, your kingdom, your kingdom is flowing, Lord. And when I look at the blood, all I see is love.
Pastor said it many times in this place, not to measure ourselves amongst ourselves. And as you read these words through this song, it reflects that. So let's just focus on the unity of each other and of God, depending on his blood and the kingdom that comes forth.
But I can't see competition. I can't see hierarchy. I can't see pride or prejudice or abuse of authority. I can't see lust for power. I can't see manipulation. I can't see rage or anger or selfish ambition. When I look unforgiveness, I can't see hate or envy, I can't see stupid fighting or bitterness or jealousy, I can't see empire building, I can't see self-importance, I can't see backstabbing or vanity or
love.
Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, Riabashanda Kahi, did he la 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 la? He Griabagashana la 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 la. Uriakashambagahi.
Yes, Lord. Your glory, Lord. Your glory and your presence. Your presence, oh God. We call on you, Lord.
Temple of the Lord was not packed out. We've seen this place like it is right now many times. I believe the Lord is creating a holy of holies in this place. And those that are called specifically for this time, including you, Jamie, don't think you're just because you're working with the children. You are part of what's going on, okay? There were only those that were called by the Lord of a lineage that the Lord has created through Christ and grafted us in. I'd rather have this place filled with the glory of the Lord than packed with people. That's where my heart's at. I'm not ashamed of that. I've been in places that have been packed out with either 3,000 to 5,000 to 50,000 to 60,000 people. And the presence of the Lord was not there. It feels like an empty tomb. Lord, we just want your habitation. We just want your habitation. You'll take care of the rest, Lord. You'll take care of your kingdom. You always have, Lord. You always will. You are doing a new work here, Lord. You are rebirthing, Lord. What has been in your heart all along. And many people don't understand it. And when they don't understand it, they fear. And they anger. They may lash out. They may hate. But Lord, forgive them. Forgive them, Lord. Help us to love them. And help us to love you even more, Lord. But help us mostly, Lord, to focus on what it is that you are wanting. What is the burden of your heart, Lord? What is the burden of your heart, Lord? What is the burden of your heart, Lord? Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes, Lord. We want this to be a habitation of your presence, Lord. That your kingdom may come forth. as never before, Lord. This land needs it so bad, so desperately, Lord. So desperate, Lord. Inhabit, Lord. Inhabit. Inhabit her. Lord, yes, Lord. Bring it forth, Lord. Let it rain down in this place, Lord. Exalt your holy name in this place, Lord. Bring your heavens down, Lord.
All afternoon there was a song, an old song going through my head. You know how sometimes it gets stuck in there, but and it was talking about the blood. You know, we were, sin had stained us, but his blood has made us white as snow. And it's talking about the righteousness that we are in Christ. And with every with every move of God, there has been a revelation. I'm not saying everything we've called revival was necessarily revival, or at least not necessarily a complete move of God. It may have been a stirring in the hearts of some people, and it produced some things. But every real move of God, however you want to describe it, whether there's a reformation, whether it was revival, whether it was renewal, whatever it might have been, any real move of God has come with revelation.
Yes.
And it's come in a way that would have been least expected at the time. And most of the time it brought chaos before it brought... I mean, think about the Reformation. Buddy, I'm telling you, that was... To stand up and say the just shall live by faith is one thing. Mm-hmm. But to be martyred,
yeah,
and all of the things that came with that.
Yes.
And that's true in every genuine move of God. There's been great persecution and what seems to be heresy and separation and isolationism and all of these things. And I think my personal feeling is, and is, this is just a microcosm of what God's really doing in the kingdom right now, in the body of Christ, what we see here. And I'm not judging or critiquing or, you know, trying to figure out what anybody else is doing. I just know that there's always the winnowing down before the victory, before the complete move that God wants to do, so that the people that are there know that it was God.
Yes.
It wasn't some charismatic leader. It wasn't some other aspect of intellect or what have you, but it was God. The problem is, in that process, many people go home.
Yeah.
You know, think of, I was just thinking of Gideon. You know, everybody that doesn't want to,
yeah,
go on home. And a bunch of them went home. I mean, they didn't even think about it twice. They just thought, I'm not sure this is God. And if it's not God, I don't want to be anywhere around it. They didn't have enough discernment and confidence and faith. So this is not to judge people that have come or gone or whatever. It's just, I'm just simply saying there are always a 300. There's always a group. There's always a certain number, small as it might be, that God ends up choosing to use because it brings glory to Him. And it eliminates the understanding of man just being able to try to figure it out. And if you think of it, the word revival, and I understand we use that term all the time, but I'm not really, revival is not what we're after. Mm-hmm. Revival, by definition, means to go back to something that has been. And I think God really does want to do a new thing. And that new thing is that it's Him and Him alone. And that's what all of this is about us coming to this. We talked about it over and over and over in all kinds of different ways, in testimonies and messages preached and so on, but in this rest. The rest simply means God does it.
Yeah.
And we don't.
Amen.
And it's so hard for us, even knowing this, to not want to do something to make it happen, you know? And I'm not saying we should just lay down and fold our hands behind our head and say, well, whatever. No, I mean, we do what we do. We occupy, mm-hmm, with the understanding that this is more about us keeping our head from blowing up than it is about making God do something.
Yeah.
God's got a plan. We just don't know exactly what that plan is, and we want to know.
Right.
We don't like being outside the plan. We want to know what the plan is. We want the details. We want to know what's going to... Somebody said... I was talking to Roberto the other day, and I said, you know, someone said that the good thing about the future is it only comes one day at a time. Well, that's also the bad thing about the future.
Yeah, exactly.
Because we want to know what's going to happen a week from now, or a year from now, or 5 years from now. And God wants us to walk by faith.
Yes.
The just shall live by faith, and the just will walk by faith. So, it, you know, it's not wrong to not know everything. It's not bad to not know everything. I mean, anybody who claims to have all the answers is either an idiot or a liar.
Yeah.
Because it's just not possible. Not if you're dealing with God. With man, that might make some sense, but with God, it's just not possible. All things are possible except us to know everything that God's going to do, when he's going to do it, how he's going to do it. A lot of times we find out in the middle of the fact that he's doing it that this is what he's doing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like in a church service. I mean, how many times has it happened where just all of a sudden God starts doing something, and we go, whoa! He's going another direction, or he's doing something else. Well, he didn't just make up his mind to do that. We just got the idea that he's doing that. It just connected with our spirit that this is where he's going, and we want to be on board. So, you know, the biggest challenge for any church, which is just people, I mean, that's what the church is to be able to trust God. Despise not the time of small beginnings. You say, well, yeah, come on, but how long is the beginning? Well, Winston Churchill said it like this. We haven't, you know, when the war was starting to turn, and he said, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said something to the effect that this is just the beginning. It's not even the end of the beginning. It's just the beginning. And we've got a whole war to fight before we get to the end. And in the meantime, there'll be the middle of the beginning, and then the end of the beginning, and then the beginning of the end.
Yes.
And that's what I think. You know, okay, so we're in the beginning.
Yeah.
It's not even the end of the beginning. We're just still in the beginning.
Yeah.
So don't get freaked out and throw in the towel and give up, because there has to be a beginning before mm-hmm. there can be an end to the beginning, and before there can become a beginning to the end.
Amen.
And when we get to the end, none of this will matter anyway, because we'll already be out of here.
Amen.
It matters now because we want to get to the end.
Right.
But we got to get to the end of the beginning before we can get to the end. Amen?
Amen.
So we just need to trust God, trust each other. And as the song said, it's so easy, you know, when you're under pressure. I mean, how many of you know Sheila runs a business, you know, different ones here work in business, and whatever you do, There's always times when pressure is on. I don't care what your job is, whether it's sales, you know, whatever. Whatever it is, there's always certain times when there's a lot of pressure put on you. That's when you want the easiest time to freak out, get mad at a coworker, get mad at the boss, get mad at your husband, get mad at your spouse, get mad at the kids, get mad at somebody, because pressure. Well, the church is no different. When the enemy begins to apply pressure, it's easy for strife, misunderstanding, where you might say it face to face 100 times and never think anything of it, and then all of a sudden somebody says, what would they mean by that? You know, because you already got the thin skin going, and it's easy to get, as we used to say years ago, they have their sensors out. So when they have their sensors out, anything you say can be sensed and thought wrong and felt. So it shouldn't surprise us that because of that, people do get kind of thin-skinned. People do get upset. People do overreact. Our responsibility is to not overreact with them. Give them the grace to overreact and then settle down. And amen? It's all good. It'll still be okay. We do that with our family all the time. And this is family. I mean, we don't have a problem getting upset with a brother, a sister, a child. We do. It happens every day. It's life. But we don't hold a grudge.
Right.
We just move on. I'm not happy with you today. You know, I don't like you today. Come back tomorrow. I'll like you tomorrow, but today I don't want to deal with you, because I'm liable to say just about anything today that'll hurt you or bother you or whatever. So just back off. And tomorrow I'll be more real. And I'll be able to deal with you in a more real way, okay? So, you know, let's don't freak out. People get upset. People say things. People do things. But it's okay. That's just people. We just move on. Jesus was talked about all the time. He was criticized. He was ridiculed. He wasn't doing enough. He was doing too much. He was doing this. He was doing that. He was getting drunk. He was hanging out with the wrong people. He was whatever. He wasn't focused on his ministry, you know. I mean, all these kinds of things. I mean, read it, and you see it all the time. Well, people say the same thing about you.
Yep.
Just praise the Lord. Fix your eye towards Jerusalem, Amen.
Amen.
And just keep on keeping on.
Amen.
God will be there.
Amen.
And his plan and his purpose will be fulfilled.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. Just as surely as what Suzanne said about expectation and so forth as individuals, we need to think that way about the church as a whole. God's favor is on us. Nobody wants him to move. It should be on, I think. Or either that or I turned it off when I came up here. I don't know which. I know I flipped a button anyway. So, but anyhow, you know, God wants us as a body to have the same kind of positive expectations for what he wants to do here as he wants in our own personal lives. And you can't, you know, let's face it, you can't really do that if you're always looking at the circumstances. As Suzanne so eloquently put it, you know, this, you know, to paraphrase her, I shouldn't have this job. But I do have it. And I have it because God gave it to me. So I can expect that if God gave it to me, he's got a plan to make something really good happen here. Well, it's the same way with the church. You know, we might look around and say, I don't get this. Hey, he put us here, so he's got a plan. And the plan is not to humiliate us or to embarrass us or whatever. The plan is for him to fulfill his plan. And in order for that to happen, we have to have an expectation of good from God. We have to believe that in spite of what it looks like or in spite of what our talents or lack thereof, he's going to do this. We just have to be faithful. I mean, in the natural, people judge by numbers, you know, a person's external appearance maybe, or their gift of gab or whatever it might be. But the guy that runs the company only cares about the bottom line. If that is taken care of, he's happy. Amen. So that's what we have to do. We have to just be concerned with the bottom line. The bottom line is God wants to see this happen more than we do. No matter how badly we want it to happen, it's more in God's interest than it is in any one of ours. So all we have to do is trust him and try to keep our words in line with our belief. So we're not undermining everything every time something negative happens, and then we jump on that and say, oh my God, well, you know, here we go. It's just stuff. It means nothing to God. You know, I mean, like, to use the Gideon example again, I mean, first it was Gideon says, not me, surely not me. I'm a nothing, I'm a nobody, I come from a bunch of nobodies, from a tribe of nobodies, a family of nobodies. I'm a nobody. And God said, I want to make you a somebody. I want to make you a child of mine. Well, now you want me to fight an army. I'm not a warrior. I don't have an army. The army's really big out there. They're vicious. And God says, well, the problem is you've got too much of an army. You got too many. You got too much. Let's cut it down. Let's cut it down. I mean, that had all seem insane. It only makes sense that the church should be full of people. Because what kind of a church is it if it's not full of people? Well, based on that, it's God's kind of church. Doesn't mean he's going to keep it that way, but that kind of a church that has a move of God, everybody's got to look at it and go, what in the world is happening over there? 30 people and all of a sudden, miracles, signs and wonders, not enough room to get people in the building. You know what I'm saying? But that, I don't care what it looks like. It's like anything else. There's no such thing as an overnight success. It only looks like overnight success to the people that show up the next morning. Right. But to the person who's going through the overnight success, it went on for 30 years. Right. It just looked like overnight, you know? And that's the same way with what we're talking about here with the move of God. People go, wow, it just happened overnight. Well, no, it only happened overnight to you because you weren't here for the last 15 years dealing with the day-to-day nothing, what seemed to be nothing. Amen?
Amen.
So I want to talk to you a little bit tonight about some justification, and I'll try to be brief and get through it as quickly as possible. So with that in mind, Sheila, if you want to get Romans chapter 1, I'll give these to you. If you want to write them down, you can just bring them up in the order that I give them to you. And I'm going to talk a little bit before we go to them. But first, Romans 1, 17. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7. Then Psalms 71, verses 14 through 16. And then Isaiah 61, verse 10. And that's just the opening verses, praise the Lord, as my text tells me. Anybody ever hear of the Dreyfus affair? It wasn't a love affair. But there was a French Jew in the late 1800s, early 1900s, I can't remember the exact dates, 1800s, I guess, who was a French officer, low-grade officer, probably a captain or a lieutenant, and he was accused of treason. And they had a trial, and it was a huge thing. Books were written about it. Historically, it was a big deal in French history. But they found him guilty of treason, and they sentenced him to Devil's Island. So off he goes to Devil's Island. Everybody saw Dustin Hoffman. And praise the Lord. Steve McQueen. That's where he went. They weren't there then, but Dreyfus was. But the people, there was a huge uproar because a lot of the people suspected, and rightfully so, that he was just railroaded because he was a Jew. And things were made up about him, and lies were told, and half-truths, and some evidence wasn't presented, some evidence was falsified, and so on and so forth. But for years, he languished on Devil's Island until enough evidence and enough public pressure came against the French that they had to bring him back, and they gave him a pardon. They didn't retry him, they just pardoned him. He lived for the next 12 years basically as an outcast, couldn't find a job. He was out of the military, so he didn't have any pension, couldn't find work anywhere and everything else. How many of you know a pardon is not an exoneration? It's saying you're guilty, but we're going to let you go. I mean, every president, when they go out of office, they just start pardoning people all over the place. And it isn't that these people were not guilty. They were guilty. That's why they're in jail. They just pardon them and let them go. So the stigma of guilt is still there. So Dreyfus went through this for like 10 or 12 years, and then finally he got a new trial. And in the new trial, he was completely exonerated. People were exposed that had lied, false information that was given came out. All of these things happened. And so he was totally exonerated, reinstated in the military with a promotion to major, and his slate, in other words, was wiped completely clean, and his life was totally transformed because of it. So with that in mind, that's why I'm only saying that because there's a difference. With pardon, there's still guilt. But with justification, there's innocence. And so that's the idea. A lot of people preach only one side of what Christ did at the cross, the forgiveness of sin. And even that, when it's taught, it's taught in a way that it is only a judicial pardon. And that's not the case. Because what we're teaching here, what we're believing here, what we're testifying about and believe that the Bible emphatically tells us is the finished work of Jesus. His death, burial, and resurrection brought us way more than a pardon for sin. It brought justification. Now, We ask the question, why is that so important to us spiritually? I mean, how does that affect our well-being? Well, understanding that I have been completely justified and declared righteous, no matter what I do, no matter what I've done, no matter how many times I fail, that sustains me through all of my failures, through all my sins, and through a lot of just stupid choices. I'm not pardoned. I'm not still carrying around the stigma of guilt. I'm justified.
Hallelujah.
Amen? I mean, I have been justified. Mm-hmm. Knowing I've been justified, that brings tremendous freedom. It allows us to enjoy God's plans without worrying that my failures will somehow hinder his plans or somehow separate me from him. If I didn't believe in this message, I'd look out here and say, God's getting even. Because I know I screw up. I know I still fail. I know I still make wrong decisions. And I know you do too. But knowing this tells me that that can't be the case.
Right.
Because in every other church,
right. There's
the same failure. I don't care if the church has 10,000 people or 50,000 people. There's as much failure there. In fact, there's more failure because there's more people there to fail. Mm-hmm. If we ever see mass revival, we got to boldly proclaim and fiercely defend the doctrine of justification. The doctrine of justification is what brought about the Reformation. Changed the whole climate, the whole atmosphere, the entire landscape of religion. Brought about the very possibility that God could begin to speak to people again in a way that they wouldn't be considered heretics or insane people. So, Romans 1:17. For therein is the righteousness of God. Therein is the righteousness of God, revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Okay? So herein is the righteousness of God. It's revealed. How is the righteousness of God revealed? From faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, those of you that are here have the benefit of, and I say that evangelistically. No, I mean, you have the benefit of knowing this message because of what I'm going to preach on Sunday. There's some things here that I just don't, you don't have time to do it all in one message. So, but there's some things here, and this is part of it. The righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, so what's God saying? He's saying, I need you in order to reveal my righteousness. And the way that you reveal my righteousness is from faith to faith. We are revealing the righteousness of God right now. You see what I'm saying? Because it's by faith that we're here. We're not here because the building is overflowing and, you know, there's, you know, this just the sense of, wow, this is the place to be because everybody's here. We're here by faith.
Right.
That reveals the glory of God. It reveals the righteousness of God.
Yes.
Now, you cannot tell me that that isn't what God wants because that's everything that the Bible tells us.
Yeah.
In other words, more righteous, the more... There is more righteousness of God, if you are with me here, there is more of the righteousness of God being revealed right here tonight than there is in many mega churches where there are thousands and thousands of people, because they're not there by faith, they're there by sight. God isn't being, his righteousness isn't being revealed. Their humanity, their flesh, their, I'm not putting them down. I'm not saying that, you know, I'm just saying here it takes faith. Therefore, God's righteousness is being revealed by the scripture, by his own words. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. Now, actually, this is a preliminary message that makes what I'm going to preach Sunday more sense. So you're going to know what I'm talking about. Everybody else is going to be sitting there with a blank look on their face like they usually have. Like, what is he talking about? Praise the Lord. But at least I'll know there'll be eight people saying praise the Lord and actually meaning it. Hallelujah. So, all right. Wisdom of God in the mystery. Hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. All right. Now let's go to Psalm 71, verses 14 through 16. But I will hope continually. I remember someone talking about hope here a few weeks back. I think it was Suzanne. I will hope continually and will yet praise thee more and more. My mouth shall show forth thy righteousness and thy salvation all the day, for I know not the numbers thereof. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only.
Yes.
Now that was David, but he was speaking prophetically, and that's where we are. The words that we speak of the righteousness of God. Not my righteousness, not your righteousness, but everything we're talking about here declares his righteousness. Our sense of good expectation, of a good outcome, of blessing, of favor, that's speaking of the righteousness of God because we're saying it by faith.
Yes.
Amen? I'll go in the strength of the Lord. Not my strength, not my ability, not my plan or scheme or whatever, but in the strength of the Lord, I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Okay? Isaiah 61 and verse 10. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. Now, how can you not believe what was being said here tonight in the testimonies and so forth and not rejoice in the Lord? I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with garments, the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with jewels. That's the way God does for us. That's what he does. That's his attitude, amen, toward us, right? Mm-hmm. Praise God. So, if we go back to Romans 1:17, where he says, the just shall live by faith. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, based on that scripture and many others, it tells us that there aren't any degrees of justification. The brand new Christian, just got saved 5 minutes ago, is as justified as the most mature Christian. We're considered blameless and righteous, whether we sin a little or we sin a lot. Somebody ought to say hallelujah, praise the Lord. Amen. We've been forgiven. Hallelujah. But we have also been fully justified by faith alone, imputed with the righteousness of God and placed into his royal family. That's what he's done. We could not be in his family if we hadn't been justified. If our sins hadn't been dealt with. I mean completely dealt with, not just covered up or pardoned, but done away with.
Yes.
All right, let's look at Titus chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. looking for that blessed hope and that glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Chapter 3, verses 5 through 7. Find out what those works are. Because immediately we think, do here. Not talking about what's on Sally's car. I'm talking about the works. Praise the Lord. Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Praise the Lord. Amen. We are only, our only responsibility, all God asks is that we embrace and celebrate what God has chosen to do for us. That's what David was talking about. That's what Isaiah was talking about. That's what Paul and Titus here are talking about. Amen. Back to Isaiah 61 and 10. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with jewels. Amen. The free gift isn't like the result of that one man's sin. Romans chapter 5. Beginning at verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Verse 13. For unto the law sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law, or when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. Let me just read it this way. The free gift isn't like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, right? But the free gift following many trespasses brought justification.
Yes.
Yeah. Now think about that. Condemnation came by one failure.
Sure.
Justification came by a whole lot of them.
Yeah.
Which tells you that grace is far greater than the law. For if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man. Look at the irony here from a a religious perspective. If because of one man's trespass death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. It's like a slap in the face. Death reigned because of one man's one sin. And now we reign in life, over life, because of one man's justification.
Amen.
For our sins. Grace, because of grace. Amen? Amen. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so the act of righteousness, one act of righteousness, leads to justification and life for everybody.
Thank you, Lord.
Who will believe. Amen?
Lord.
So righteousness isn't the result of work. Righteousness is the result of one act.
Exactly.
You say, well, what's the big deal about one? Well, people argue about, well, there's many ways to God, and blah, 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 blah. The Bible says one.
Right.
Jesus. Why? Because of this one act.
Right.
It's the only way you can be reconciled to God. My dad used to say, this always rings true with me when it comes to that kind of thing. He'd say, go get me another. You say, well, what's so big deal about that? What if there isn't another?
Come on. Jesus.
So just give me another Savior. Give me a different religion. Give me another choice. But there isn't any other.
There it is.
So don't ask me to go get you another. Because you got the only one.
Uh-huh.
And when you've got the only one, it's precious.
Yes.
It has value.
Yes.
Unlike any other.
Uh-huh.
We've got nothing to be ashamed of.
Right.
Nothing to feel guilty about.
Mm-hmm.
And now, if we'd only been pardoned, then we might deserve the stigma that follows a pardoned criminal. But we weren't really pardoned. We've been fully justified. Just as though we had never broken God's law. Praise God. No more scarlet letter on us. No more record of our failures. The life of the believer, and this is what I believe will usher in the next real move of God. The life of the believer can be revolutionized. It can really be changed and transformed. I hear it all the time. Oh, this message will change your life. I've heard a lot of messages, and none of them really changed my life. They might have stirred me up for a little while. They might have done this or that, but this is what will change your life. Because if you really, really believe, it will revolutionize your life. If you genuinely understand and accept justification, nothing will ever be the same again. Let's read Romans 8, 1 through 6. It'll be the last scripture. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after this flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
Amen.
Now, he's already told us what the spiritual minded person is, the person who believes in their righteousness in Christ. Therefore, there's no condemnation. The person who's under the law is always under condemnation and guilt and shame and fear. But for us, to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
Yes.
Life and peace. Justification relieves the nagging embarrassment when we believe that God is angry or disappointed with us because we've screwed up, because we've done something bad, because we said something or acted in a way that we shouldn't have. But it's when we truly realize our sin record no longer exists. We say it's erased. Truth is, it doesn't exist.
Right.
Hebrews 11, you've got this whole list of people who by faith, and it doesn't say anything about the things that they didn't do in faith, which were many.
Exactly.
But none of them are there because there's no record of it.
Right.
The only record kept is the by faith record for any believer.
Amen.
He didn't erase it. It doesn't exist. It's when we realize that real, powerful confidence is birthed in us. A lot of us have been born again, but we've never had any confidence birthed in us. Born again and still living under guilt, under shame, under fear, under condemnation, under all of these negatives that were supposed to have been done away with in our new birth. Justification equals revival. Historically, that is what moved us into the Reformation.
Right.
what made it possible for revivals. And if you think about it, every revival since then has been some type of a move back to the Reformation.
Right.
As skewed as they may have been. I mean, some are to, you know, get better and do better and all that kind of, I understand that. But they were an effort to get back to the great, grand kind of epic move that God performed in the Reformation. A completely change the way people thought about religion. The way they thought about God. So much so that it upset the status quo to the degree that they were killing people by the thousands. And tormenting and but it led to Bibles in people's homes.
Right.
It led to people having personal relationships with God. It led to miraculous, supernatural moves of God. It led to the revelation upon revelation upon revelation, regardless of how much we screwed those revelations up and began to build denominations around each one of them. It still led to all these other revelations because of one man's revelation. It led to thousands of revelations of God and the things that God wanted to do in people's lives since then. And we're still living off of that today. And this is going to usher in, I believe, a real grasp and embracing of justification. It's all the grace message, but it's what grace brought us, justification.
Yes.
I believe that that is the thing that will usher in the greatest move of God that this world has known.
Amen.
That's described in the end times.
Mm-hmm.
Like David, like Isaiah, like Paul, like everybody who's had a revelation of justification through the finished work of Christ. It's the mystery that we read about in 2 Corinthians or in 1 Corinthians. It's a mystery of God's grace, the transformation of men and women into sons and daughters, receiving their inheritance. It's what I'm going to talk about Sunday, maturing. That's where we're at. That's what I believe where this church is at. We're in a maturing stage.
Yep.
We've got revelation. We've got information. Most of it has come to us as revelation. But as we mature, sometimes what happens is revelation doesn't really set in. It takes time.
Mm-hmm.
We call it revelation, but it's really information. What happens is as you mature, that information all of a sudden begins to be revelation. When that happens, you start walking it out. You start living it. You start expressing it. That's when God's righteousness is revealed. That's when miracles happen. That's when God moves. It isn't that he isn't moving. It's just that that's when people look and say, that was God. This was a God thing. That was a God thing. You see what I'm saying? We're children. He wants sons and daughters. He wants us to grow up into the full stature of Jesus Christ. That's a son. That's a daughter. Speaking, you know, gender specific here. But so, I mean, we're all sons. But I'm just saying, this process that we're in, you see, maturing, it isn't necessarily always that visible. A lot of times we don't even know we're maturing. Until you look back and realize how immature some of your behavior was, you know, and your attitudes and your thoughts and your actions, you know. But God is maturing us. It's him. He does it.
Yes.
And that's what we've talked about. It's in the scripture. It talks about babes. Religious people are babies. They don't want to hear that. It offends them. But it's the truth based on the word of God. The more mature you become, the fewer rules you have to have.
Yep.
God is trying to tear up the rule book. He tore it up 2,000 years ago,
right.
In fact. But he's trying to get us to tear it up so that we can be led by the Spirit,
Amen.
So that we can walk in him, so that we can reveal him. Not rules and regulations and laws and religions, but reveal him.
Amen.
That's when the righteousness of God is revealed in the earth. And how is it revealed? Through us. As we rest in him, as we trust in him. It's the only way this great move of God, this last day revival, if you will, can take place.
Right.
God is not sharing this with people any longer.
Right.
He's winked at, you know, these things in the past because it was needed to move us along the path. But always in the fullness of time, something really supernatural happens. There have been moments in time that God has done things. But in the fullness of time, he sent forth his son. He sent forth ambassadors from heaven. He sent forth prophets and priests and so forth. But in the fullness of time came the real image of God. I think that's what we're looking at now. Because in the last days, there's going to be a revelation of Jesus Christ, and it's going to be right here, us. And we have to be mature in order for that revelation to be real, in order for his righteousness to really be expressed. He needs sons and daughters,
Amen.
Not just men and women.
That's right.
Amen? Praise the Lord. Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen. God bless you. And you're still out of here before 9 o'clock. Hallelujah. God bless you. Come back Friday night. Come expecting these memorials to come up before us and to come up before God. Not that he's forgotten them, but he likes to be reminded of them. So that he can bring them to pass. And we know that when that happens, it was God that did it. Amen. See y'all Friday night.